Hi guys, welcome back to our channel. In case you're new here, my name is Maren.
And I'm Maureen.
So how many of you guys remember Muammar Gaddafi?
Good question.
He was one of the most famous African presidents.
Right.
And he was really known for, you know, spearheading the
unity of Africa.
Exactly.
And the days leading up to him being deleted, it said that the West was the one who had him deleted. And they turned his own people against him with the help of a African leader.
Yeah,
so now this name of this African leader, it has been exposed. You may wonder why his name has been exposed right now, but that doesn't matter. Today we are going to be focusing on the African leader who betrayed Muammar Gaddafi to the West and fed him to the wolves. Let's watch this and then we come back and talk about it.
Muhammad Gaddafi, the former Libyan leader, was one of Africa's rulers, who left a very strong mark on the continent. He spent his life reinventing himself and is widely remembered for his push for the United States of Africa. Even after 40 years in power, Muammar Gaddafi had grand ambitions for his country and Africa. The story of his downfall is greatly centered around love, money, and betrayal, but the landmark he created is still one of the most remarkable in the 21st century. During his reign, Muammar Gaddafi showed much love towards a particular country, its people, and the president of this country. But at the end of it all, it was this same president, the same one he considered his friend, that betrayed him. So which country is this, and who is its leader? The country we are talking about here is Uganda, and the leader that betrayed Gaddafi was no other than the Ugandan leader who propagated his betrayal. In 2016, President Yoweri Kaguta Museveni of Uganda wrote a letter criticizing the United States and the African Union for their intervention in Libya and the wide Middle East region. He also stated that the US and the European Union had no business dislodging Gaddafi and Saddam Hussein of Iraq. But why did Museveni betray Gaddafi? Before we get in deep into why, let us see how they even got close to each other, how they became friends, and what really happened that Museveni had to betray his own friend. Gaddafi's relationship with Uganda didn't just start when Museveni came to power. Gaddafi had been a longtime friend of Uganda. His relationship with this country he loved so much started as far back as the 1970s during Idi Amin's regime. He provided so much support for this nation, moral, economic, and military support to Amin's government during this period. Each time Idi Amin's government was faced with an attack, there would always be one person who would come to his rescue, sending troops and military support. It was no other person but Gaddafi. But all his support and friendship ended in him being betrayed, as you will soon find out what happened. The attacks and resistance against Idi Amin, he fled the country in 1979 for Libya, where he later on moved and settled in Saudi Arabia. After Amin was overthrown in 1980, Uganda decided to organize an election to choose its next leader. The result did not favor Museveni, so he would do what any other power-hungry person would do. He claimed the elections were rigged and that it was unfair. This dragged Uganda into a civil war between Museveni and the other opposition. Museveni and his army ran short of weapons and ammunition during this war. He would need help from somewhere. He just had to win this war. He was too power hungry. So what did he do? He had to look for help. He approached no other but the US and the UK for arms help. His request was turned down because of his closeness with Muammar Gaddafi. He then went to Gaddafi, the closest friend of his country. Gaddafi never hesitated. Gaddafi gave him all the help he needed, gave him military supplies, and he emerged victorious. Gaddafi gave his support on several occasions, including the Ugandan Civil War of 1986, which Museveni still emerged victorious. After the defeat of Paul Kwanga Samugerere, Libya trained Museveni's military. In fact, Museveni even named his secret intelligence agency after its Libyan counterparts. That's how much love and support Gaddafi showed Museveni. Gaddafi visited Uganda frequently, which would make one think it was his second home. He invested a lot in Uganda and built so many infrastructures. Gaddafi, through the Libyan African portfolio, invested and bought 51% of shares in Uganda's telecommunications corporation, Uganda Telecom, and 60% shares of the textile company known as TriStar Limited. Gaddafi even convinced Museveni not to sell Uganda's unrefined oil to Europe and the West. He promised him he'd help him build a refinery and pipelines to Kenya and other neighboring countries. That wasn't all. Gaddafi also made thunderous investments in the finance and real estate sectors of Uganda's economy, which included the investment he made in the Tropical Bank of Africa, National Housing Corporation, Lake Victoria Hotel, and so many other companies. One other fact you have to note is that through Museveni, Gaddafi also funded the RPF rebels after they invaded Rwanda in 1980. The support he gave them included arms that were flown into Uganda by the Museveni regime. That is how deep their friendship was, which is what made the betrayal even more painful. Let us also take a look at Gaddafi's interest in the Touro Kingdom. Muhammad Gaddafi developed an interest in this kingdom, located within the borders of Uganda in 2001. At this time, its ruler, King Oyonimba, was just 9 years old. Because of his extreme love for this kingdom, Muhammad Gaddafi financed the majority of the projects there, including the construction of the Touro Palace. Gaddafi left a lasting legacy in the Ugandan Muslim community. He contributed voluminously to the construction of the magnificent mosque there, which has a capacity of holding at least 3,000 faithful. This mosque is the second largest in Eastern Africa. Gaddafi even joked with Museveni, asking him to rule for life during his visits to Uganda. He went further asking him why he even bothered going for elections. On one of his visits there, he promoted one of Museveni's sons in the military from captain to major. In the 2001 and 2006 presidential elections, Gaddafi supported Museveni to carry out his campaigns. Their relationship seemed so strong and unbreakable, but that was not the case till the end. What actually prompted Museveni to pull down Gaddafi? We shall examine this in two main parts, which are Western interests and Muhammad Gaddafi's ambitions. As you might already know, Muhammad Gaddafi is the highest person talked about each time the idea of a United States of Africa has been raised.
His ideas for African unity involve the creation of a United States of Africa.
Just like Kwame Nkrumah of Ghana. Gaddafi poured a lot of effort into the quest for African unity. During a summit held in 1989, Gaddafi succeeded to convince 45 heads of state to approve the creation of an African Union, which replaced the Organization of African Union. For more than 10 years after this, Gaddafi stood as the most popular advocate for this union. Still, in 1989, he came up with the idea of the United States of Africa, which he envisaged will have a single currency and military. The African Union, according to him, was to be used as a facilitator for this dream of his. Roughly 15% of the money used to finance projects of the African Union came from Libya during Gaddafi's reign. This, however, was a scary idea to Western powers and some African leaders, who thought this will distort their prestige, influence, and position in the continent. The idea brought division among African leaders on the matter. Surprisingly, Yoram Museveni was also against this idea. Museveni was a man that Gaddafi had helped a lot in the past and even made him gain much power in Uganda. He had invested a lot in his country and backed him in times of need. Why did Museveni disagree with Gaddafi's idea of creating the United States of Africa? First, it was a threat to his grip on power in Uganda.
So guys, I'm aware of Mr. Gaddafi's approaches and efforts to get a foothold in your part of Africa and all. And I just like to intervene in caution.
He appreciated Gaddafi's take in a flattery manner, but did not actually fight for the course. He refused to be ruled by another leader. It will either be him or no one else. Secondly, Museveni's power was becoming much felt in the region, and in this position, he served the interest of the West through military actions in countries like Somalia. He also provided intellectual support to the CIA leaders.
Mr. President, I started fighting Gaddafi before you started.
What?
I started fighting Gaddafi before you started.
With this, he prioritized the interest of the West before those of his African compatriots. When this decision was finally tabled in an African Union meeting in Accra, Ghana in 2007, Museveni fiercely shot it down. He feared that supporting the idea of African unity will create problems between him and the Western powers. He was aware that these people kept him in power and could oust him from there at any moment. Museveni was also afraid that, upon betraying Gaddafi, he will face some difficulties in his military and financial whereabouts. He knew so well that resisting Gaddafi was far easier than resisting the West. The betrayal of Gaddafi was accelerated by Museveni's reactions. On June 13, 2008, during his son's graduation in the United States, Museveni expressed his consent to the Assistant Secretary General of State for African Affairs, Jende Fraser. He said he did not deem a united Africa necessary due to linguistic and cultural differences. He went further to say that Gaddafi bribed small African countries to support him and made it difficult for them to speak out during African Union and other international meetings. Museveni noted that tensions with Gaddafi, which kept growing, will result in an attack on his plane while flying over international space. He requested help from the United States of America, which he did receive. Gaddafi was not so worried about Museveni's relationship with America, but his popularity in Uganda. When Gaddafi paid a surprise visit to Uganda in 2008, Museveni's government saw it as a plotted attack on their president. During a 37-minute talk at an Arab youth event in Uganda, Gaddafi switched talk and said that he wanted now to work with traditional leaders and not elected presidents to achieve his plans for the United States of Africa. In 2009, he brought together some African traditional leaders to discuss the unity of the continent. When this came to Museveni's notice, he blocked Ugandan traditional rulers from attending the meeting. Museveni had convinced Gaddafi that the United States president at the time, George Bush, removed sanctions on Libya and will carry out investment in his country if he destroyed his weapons of mass destruction. After talks with some British diplomats, Gaddafi was told that Museveni had sold him alive.
Declare and then to begin to dismantle the nuclear program and the chemical weapons program. You said at the time that Libya expected some enormous benefit, a very real benefit. And many people in Libya say they're still waiting for that benefit. What is Libya waiting for? What do you expect from the West?
I don't believe America fulfilled its commitments and pledges vis-à-vis Libya regarding this point. We have been told that President Bush is a man that honors his own word, and so far we are not so sure of that.
What specifically are you waiting for the U.S. to do? What complaint do you have with President Bush?
This was Gaddafi's greatest mistake that led to his downfall. He did not own a strong nuclear weapon that could neutralize NATO forces. Museveni, since then, has been trying to step into Gaddafi's shoes to champion African unity in finance and security. He is strong in some areas, but he lacks the charisma and financial power to carry out this project. He might not be supported even if he achieves this. Even the West will not, because it is the same reason they fought Gaddafi. In 2021, during one of his speeches, Museveni mentioned that the plans of the Western powers were narrow ones, and surprisingly, these are the same people that he had sold Gaddafi to. The mosque, which was built in Uganda and named the Gaddafi Mosque, was renamed 2 years after his downfall to appease their government.
Now, close to 2 years after Gaddafi was killed, the Uganda Muslim Supreme Council has dropped the name to appease the current Libyan government.
The only thing Museveni could have done was not to blackmail Gaddafi, because he was the only African leader he feared most. It is certain that when Museveni's time to drop power will come, no one will be there to save him.
So guys, allegedly, Museveni is the man who betrayed Gaddafi, and Gaddafi died because of his vision for Africa.
Mm-hmm. And I have to say, I feel like Gaddafi is the only, the only leader alive at the time. Because mm-hmm. let's just put aside Kwame Nkrumah, because we already know what they were trying to do. Mm-hmm. Gaddafi was the only leader of his time mm-hmm. who really had a greater vision for Africa mm-hmm. because he was talking about one United States of Africa. He was talking about one African currency. You know, right now there are leaders like PLO, Lumumba, who are talking about these things.
Yeah, but this is not just a talk that started today.
Yesterday.
It started mm-hmm. a long time ago with Gaddafi and other leaders like Nkrumah, you know.
Yeah.
But the West has always interfered with this vision.
Mm-hmm.
Should any leader stand up and start talking about this, they always delete that leader, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And my thing is, it is those closest to you that always get you.
Mm-hmm.
Because Gaddafi had very, very strong investments in Uganda.
Mm.
You can almost be forgiven for saying he owned Uganda.
Mm.
He owned Uganda.
Mm-hmm.
And if you ask me, should Museveni have been the one to betray him? Why would he betray him?
Mm-hmm.
First of all, for greed and money.
Mm.
Because all the shares that Gaddafi had, once he died, obviously his shares and his money in Uganda went to the only one family that was
mm-hmm.
a proxy to him,
mm-hmm.
the Museveni family.
Yeah, and because I'm not saying that
Museveni family, you know, so
and
that money went to Museveni's family.
Yeah, and you know, one thing that always disappoints me about African leaders
mm-hmm.
is the fact that instead of seeing the whole bigger picture in what somebody is trying to do and all of you to be progressive into the kind of discussions that need to be had
mm-hmm.
for Africa to be great,
they only see the carrot.
Exactly, they think individually, you know.
Mm-hmm.
So now Gaddafi was talking about one united Africa. That
right.
would have meant we have one president, you understand?
Yeah,
but
and other representatives in the different African countries.
Yeah,
but you would be using even one currency,
mm-hmm.
the gold currency.
Mm-hmm.
Right now, Russia BRICS, they're trying to make gold to be the main currency. But imagine you guys,
that's the
Gaddafi
same
back in his time, that was 1989.
Mm-hmm.
That was the same vision Gaddafi was trying to push to some of the African states.
Mm-hmm.
That was the same vision Gaddafi had,
mm-hmm.
meaning, should these African leaders have just put their greed aside and worked with Gaddafi, right now Africa would be a power play in the world economy,
and
you know,
world politics.
And guys, now that Museveni's name is being thrown out there as the guy who betrayed Gaddafi, I feel like the people he betrayed Gaddafi to, there's a reason they're leaking his name right now, you know.
Mm.
Maybe they want him to meet the same fate Gaddafi did, because there's a certain threat he's posing to them right now.
Mm-hmm.
And after Gaddafi's death, a few times later, Museveni, that hypocrite, Museveni tried to step into Gaddafi's shoes, but he wasn't just liked by many, and people knew he was Gaddafi's friend, and people thought he was the one who betrayed Gaddafi, so people didn't trust him.
Mm.
Specifically, many African leaders didn't trust him.
Mm.
So,
and this is what the West always does.
Yeah,
divide and conquer, and they're doing a very good job at that,
because they find morally poor people mm. who are leading those countries,
mm.
and then they use those people to assert their will and power.
Right.
You find like someone like Gaddafi, when he was calling for a united Africa, Museveni was one of those
who knew his agenda.
Who knew his agenda very well, what he was trying to do, and yet he was the first person to stand up and say Africa can't be united because of linguistic differences and what
like,
did he call it? Cultural differences.
You guys, like, come on.
Mm-hmm.
Tell me a single country in Africa that doesn't know, talk or understand English
mm-hmm.
first. And secondly, I was hearing that some African countries were pushing for the Swahili to be the international language of
in
Africans.
Africa. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, because
so I feel
was
like,
it in South Africa? Julius
mm-hmm.
Malema was also pushing for the idea
mm-hmm.
because Swahili is already being spoken by multiple nations.
Yeah.
So he was, you know,
mm-hmm.
so I'm sure leaders like Museveni, if they wanted to truly work with Gaddafi, they'd have made things work.
Mm-hmm.
But I feel like he really just didn't align with Gaddafi's plans, because he was too selfish of a leader to let his country have a better future.
Mm, look at Uganda. It has never had any other president in 20 plus years, you know.
Yeah.
And so
they're just being led by the same old ideological man who maybe doesn't even see the future in through the lens of young people in Uganda.
Yeah.
He still sees the future through the colonial mindset.
Mm-hmm. Another thing Gaddafi was trying to do
mm.
was he was trying to make African countries cut off supplies from to the West,
yeah,
you
to
know,
the West.
Exports to the West,
and so was, that they can maintain their resources within the
Africa.
Continent.
Exactly.
So you can
trade
imagine
within each other.
Yeah, you
Africa
can
would have been a superpower.
Yeah, you can imagine all that gold that Africa produces
mm.
is within Africa.
Mm-hmm.
All that oil that some African countries
countries produces, all that diamond, all that copper, all that everything. Mm-hmm. And then when we we'd have been manufacturing some really good vehicles, you mm-hmm. know. But it's leaders, all leaders, like Museveni.
Mm-hmm.
And I'll always say this in every episode that has to concern Africa and African leadership.
Mm-hmm.
People like Ibrahim Traore, we really have hopes in such leaders. They're the mm-hmm. ones who should be given priority and support mm-hmm. to take Africa to the next level.
Mm-hmm.
Traore and the other Senegalese people, yeah, the Senegalese president, we are yet Mali. To see his work,
mm-hmm.
but let's pray he doesn't become an old fat like the other old African presidents who shall not be mentioned.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, but young presidents, I hope Africans, because Africa has a big number of young population,
mm-hmm.
I hope they just kick these old fats out and, you know, mm-hmm. choose young, new, progressive leaders, you know.
Yeah,
these old ones, they just have colonial mindset and they first want to please the West before they please their own people,
mm-hmm.
the West and, you know, and their pockets.
Yeah, and that will never work well for us because right. the West would rather have us stay or remain the way we are divided
mm-hmm.
so that they can come in and take our resources
under the earth that mm-hmm. we walk on.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so you guys, let us know after watching this video, what opinions have you formed for yourself, and do you really believe that it was that president who was very close to Gaddafi,
mm-hmm.
that was the very same one that betrayed Gaddafi? Let us know in the comment section, because my stand still is his name wouldn't just be thrown out there mm-hmm. if he wasn't the one who betrayed him. There must be smoke where there's fire. There must be fire where that smoke is coming from, you know.
Yeah.
There must be fire where that smoke is coming from. And if his name is just being thrown casually out there, hey, why not a South African leader?
Why not a leader from the west of Africa?
Yes.
Why not a leader from the north of Africa?
Or why not a leader? Of course, you know, a leader from the west did he mean. But why not a leader from Middle East? Just a leader from Africa, and his geolocation is in Uganda.
Yeah,
in Uganda, you know. So mm-hmm. you guys, let us know what you think about this episode. In my opinion, whether or not he betrayed Gaddafi, he certainly knows the story, the real story, why Gaddafi was deleted mm-hmm. and how he was deleted and why he was deleted.
Yeah.
You know.
Yeah.
And someone wants his name out there with a reason right now. The people he betrayed Gaddafi to are now betraying him.
And you know, I'm really looking at that country, Uganda,
mm.
and it's very interesting because I'm really looking at it to see who's going to be the next president.
Yeah.
Museveni is old and tired.
He's not only old and tired, but he knows only one way to deal with his opponents, by oppressing them. You saw how he handled the opposition the last time they had an election.
Mm-hmm.
He even was arresting the politicians from the opposition party just so he could be announced the president when mm-hmm. the election was over.
Mm-hmm.
What kind of a leader is that? He should mm-hmm. just give people space, go somewhere and retire peacefully, you know, mm-hmm. so that Ugandans can forget about him where in his corner that he's going to retire. Mm-hmm.
Look at Idi Amin, how it ended for him.
And you know, the sad thing is that I feel like he's grooming one of his sons to take over after him. He just doesn't want any other person to have power.
Mm-hmm.
Just him and his family.
Ugandans, what are you thinking?
What do you feel about this? I don't know. I don't like you. I have a right to not like somebody, right? I don't like Museveni. I don't like his sons. I don't like what he stands for. You know, like he should give someone a chance
to also
lead.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, he should give people a chance. Yeah, so anyway, only Ugandans know what good he's done for the country, but everybody else can see through the curtains and look at what's being cooked inside that house.
So you know, guys, let us know what you think about this episode. We really appreciate you for watching, and let's catch you on our next episode.